So sampling overview, we should be able to finish this one today. We'll start and finish it, I think, today. We'll, unless something crazy happens. Should be able to go through it. And then the chapter 7 handout internal controls, we'll start that. Okay. Don't need that. Okay. Nope. I'm sorry. There we go. I was just joking about the other stuff. Okay, sampling overview and test of control. So this is kind of like a two different things we're going on here. We're going to have a sort of a cleanup of some little stuff that you might run into on the CPA exam, for instance, that has to do with sampling, and then also going into the test of controls, which actually is tested probably more even than the substantive testing. So anyway, we'll go ahead and do that. Okay. Different types of selection of samples. The best one is random. A random sample is unbiased. Okay, a random sample is unbiased. That's why we like them. And it gives us the best estimate of the population as a whole. So random sample, yeah, and if you guys had your statistics class, this is, I'm sure you guys have gone over something like this. So random sample, we try to get a random sample, just because it is unbiased and will give us our best estimate as far as what the true population is our best estimate. It's not perfect, but it's our best estimate. Systematic selection. We'll say this is second best. This is, I got an example. Probably an example is easier than explaining it. Oops. Instead of picking things randomly, you choose them systematically. For example, choose every 10th item. So every 10th item you would pick. So if we had, say, and you can have a random start to this. So you can say have a random start between 1 and 10. Maybe 1 in 9, I guess, would be more appropriate. And then take every 10th item. Actually, between 0 and 9 would be it. Well, I think so. It would be 10, yeah. So, it would be 10, yeah. So anyway, you would take every nth item. Now, you do run into the problem that there might be something, you know, for example, let's say this. We had a random start of of 3. So we pick items. Three, 13, 23, 33, 23, you get the idea. Every 10th item we would pick. So it's possible to have a random start and then pick the items, you know, every 10th item, it would look like something like that. Now, here's the problem. Suppose that there's a problem with every item that's number 25. You have no chance of picking that one with the sample you chose. So let's say there's a problem with, you know, like say every 25th item or whatever. Well, you're not going to pick it. Right? Because it's going to go, you know, 25, 50, 75. This is not going to be ending in 3. So, and now how often does that happen? I don't know, but it's the second best. And I have used this method for picking items. Most of the time I picked random samples, but sometimes in the thing it would just say, pick every 10th item or something. Okay, haphazard selection. This is choosing a sample at the will of the auditor, and it is meant usually to try to mimic random. It's called mimic. Two M's. Okay, I'll do spell check. Ah, should have known that. I actually used this once. And so haphazard selection, one of the ways you do it is like you go to pull the file out, you close your eyes, and you pick 5 items out of the sample. Okay. Now, there is a problem with using haphazard selection, and that is it's not repeatable. So this is usually not generally used for auditing. For example, this random sample, you can have print out of the same random sample items you picked, and someone else can come and do that, and it's repeatable. So this is, two people can take, you know, if you take the same items from the random sample, the same random items, you get the same one. And same thing here. This is, you know, if you pick every 10th one, now anyone can do that, and it'll become like the same, you pick the same items. This one is not repeatable. Let's make it a different color. Let's make it, turquoise. Because I, you know, if I close my eyes and pick these items and you come by, you say, let's check your work. You come by and close your eyes and pick, you might pick completely different items. In fact, you probably would pick completely different items. So it's not repeatable in that the sample selection method cannot be repeated by someone else and get the same results. So generally speaking, you don't use the haphazard method. Yeah, let's go to the last one. Block selection. This one is block selection is probably the worst of all of them. And now probably it is the worst of all of them. The thing that block selection is for blockheads, but this is, without getting insulting on it, this is probably the worst way to do it. And I'll show you why. Block sample is when you take a block of items that are all together and test that. So for example, so you take a block, like let's say October, and use October as a sample for the entire year. What's the problem with this one? Why can't you just go out and pick October and say, okay, we're going to use October sales to estimate the sales for the whole year? What's the problem with that one? It is repeatable, by the way. It's not good, but it's repeatable. What would be a problem with this sample? If we used, say, the October sales for the, I should say, let me clean this up a little bit. Use the October sales to estimate the total year's sales. What would be the problem with that? You can put it in chat if you want. So what's the problem of using October sales to estimate the entire year's sales? Anyone? All right, I'll stop this for now. There's two problems with it. First of all, October may not represent the entire year. For instance, maybe they make a lot of sales in December. And if you're using October, which maybe is a lower month of sales than in December, you might end up with a problem there because it's not going to be accurate. Second of all, anything problem that happens in any other month of the year is not going to get caught. So if there's fictitious sales put on the books in December, you're not going to catch them. Okay, yeah, let's just go to stratification. Oh, I used haphazard one time. It was kind of strange. I used haphazard. I was doing an audit, and there was the kind of these specialized invoices that they were being done, and there was this woman that was in an office all by herself, and she was a schizophrenic. I'd go up to her and I'd talk to her, and she would just kind of look at me and make faces, and you know, sometimes she'd answer, sometimes she'd just talk like random, not to me, but and I come to find out that she was actually, she was a schizophrenic, but she had stopped taking her medication, and this was a union job that the company could not force her to take her medication. So she wasn't taking her medication, and but she was clearly, you know, schizophrenic. Anyway, I went to my, I picked my sample, I go there, and I'm asking her where these things are, and there's just boxes everywhere. I literally boxes on shelves and all over the place. And I get nothing back. I'm trying to go through the box, I'm trying to figure out, you know, the system. I can't figure it out. I don't know what it is, you know. So I go to my supervisor, I said, look, you know, it's the craziest thing. You know, they have, you know, I can't, oops, sorry about that. I can't pick a sample. There's no discernible system that I can figure out from what she has, and I can't get any information out of her. And her supervisor is kind of hands off, like, hey, I can't do anything about it. So what do I do? You know, and he said, okay, I'll just pick a haphazard one. So I picked a haphazard selection and wrote it down, which items I picked. And the kicker to that was that even though she was clearly schizophrenic, her work was absolutely perfect. There was nothing wrong with any of the invoices, which is different than the rest of the invoices. The easy invoices that I was looking at, they had problems, some of them. Not one of the invoices that I picked from her had any problems. So she was perfectly capable. but it haunted me for a while, obviously, but... yeah, so that was, I had to pick a haphazard one. We wrote up that, you know, there should be a way of organizing it. Whether that happened, I kind of don't know, but okay. Stratification. So we have a bunch of accounts receivable, and here they are. And the question is, from this first group of 10 of these accounts receivable, which ones will you be the most interested in looking at?
The largest one?
Yeah, certainly this one you'd be interested in.
So yes, five, not six.
Five. Let me do something here. I'm gonna put these back to being black so we can highlight them. Yeah, so this one is certainly one you'd want to look at. And some of the other ones are maybe significant here. Maybe this one. But there's clearly ones that you're not very interested in. For instance, number three. If number three, you know, this is almost $1 million account. If it was off by $28, no one would really care. So you're probably not terribly interested in number three. Even if it was completely fictitious, it wouldn't matter. So the idea is that not all items are of the same value to the auditor. You know, certainly the larger ones would be. So probably, certainly five and six would be in there. Which ones you want to look at? Maybe number two. Yeah. Okay. Number two might be in there. But clearly there are some things that are more interesting than others to the auditor. Okay, here's a question. Which one is most likely to be fraud? I don't know if we talked about this or not. I thought maybe we did. Out of those numbers, which one looks odd? Could be. It could be this lowest one is a strange one, because maybe it's, you know, since all these other ones are so large, maybe this one being so small is a concern. But which one of these numbers sticks out like it might not be real?
Maybe $20 because it looks small.
Yeah, well, there's a small one. The one I was thinking about is this one.
Oh.
One of the weird things about fraud, I probably didn't talk about this yet.
Looks like a too much of an even or a perfect number.
Exactly.
Random.
No, one of the odd things about fraud, or I guess maybe the people that commit it, is a lot of times they use nice big round numbers. It's very rare to have a business deal, a business, you know, come out to this kind of a number. I mean, can it happen? Yeah, it can happen, but you usually don't see it. Usually you see, you know, numbers like this. There's taxes and shipping and all, you know, whatever else there is. That having it come out to a nice perfect round number is fairly unusual. So when you see those, sometimes it raises somewhat of a concern, because a lot of times those are what we kind of deem as unnatural transactions. Can they occur? Yeah, they can occur, but it's more like for whatever reason, a lot of times frauds happen. People will do them for nice big round numbers. You know, we need 25,000 more in our sales. They put in 25,000. Instead of putting in $25,124, they put in 25,000. Okay, so here's what we do a lot of times when we do our sampling. We will stratify it. We'll say things something like this. Items over $10,000. We'll sample at 100%, my percentage. Okay, so if it's over 100,000, we're gonna take it as a, actually this wouldn't be a sample technically, but we'd look at 100% of them. So anything that's over $10,000, we're interested in. Okay, items between $10,000, scratch that, $1,000. I just say, not say between, I just say from. We're still interested in these, but maybe not as much. So I'm just making this up. Let's say 20%. And let's say that items under $1,000. Again, we're still interested in them, just not as much as the other stuff, maybe 4% of those. So we're stratifying the sample. We're looking at the big things that are, you know, more important. The sample, we actually be more for those and less for things that are worth less. You know, number six, no, excuse that, number five, it was probably material just by itself. So, you know, when we stratify the sample, this is what we're talking about. Is bringing it into layers. On that. Okay. Types of sampling plans. in the sampling plans, attribute sampling. This is one we're going to concentrate on today, actually. These are, yes, no tests. They'll call these binomials for your stats class. Binomial distributions. And they're yes or no. So, for instance, attribute. Does the purchase order have a signature on it? Yes or no? So it either has it or it doesn't. And if you had a stats class, going through the binomials was probably one of your least favorite things because the calculations get pretty sticky. But we use the normal distribution as a when we do our calculations on it, we use normal distribution. There's a nice thing about sampling. I'll show it to you. Nice thing about sampling is that wait, I need a light. I need my other camera. We can use what they call the central limit theorem. You guys may have already run into that in your stats class. And the central limit theorem is that almost any distribution that is repeated will be a normal distribution over time. I should say we're over trials, maybe is a better way to put it. So any distribution it'll be a normal distribution. So no matter what the distribution looks like, if it looks like, did something stupid. So any distribution that's repeated will be, so whatever the distribution looks like, if it looks like, this, or if it looks like, this or whatever, eventually it's going to look like a normal distribution if you repeat it. And we do the same thing for the attribute testing. So it's yes, no, it's kind of like a coin flip. So if you have a coin flip, at one flip, your possibilities look like this. Heads, tails, it's 50-50, right? So if you flip a coin once, it'll look like that. If you have two flips, you'll notice that there's a couple of possibilities. So it could look like this. It could be heads and heads, could be tails and tails. It could also be the first one is a head, the second one is a tail, or the first one's a tail and the second one's a head. Now, if we don't care about the order, and we don't for what we're doing, this each one of these would have a 25% chance. Now, there's two 25% chances here, so this will be 50. So you can kind of see, even after one or two flips, this is starting to look like that. So a lot of things, you know, if you wonder why in statistics they beat up the normal distribution so much, it's because everything, if it's repeated, will usually go into that, you know, with the normal distribution is repeated. So this is, you know, there are even chances here. This would be like a straight line or whatever you want to do it. But as you get, if you do it repeatedly, you'll get more more looking like the normal distribution. Come on. Okay. All right. So, and that's what we would use to find our sample size and all that. It would be the normal distribution. So this attribute sampling, we would use the normal distribution stuff for this. And it's much more fun than the actual way of doing the attribute sampling. Okay, discovery sampling. This is when you're looking for something particular. It could be fraud, it could be any number of things, but discovery sampling is trying to estimate either one, exceptions exist, or two, the rate of exceptions. So discovery sampling, you're really trying to figure out, so for example, well, let's say, you know, for fraud, we'd probably be doing, does a fraud exist? And what you can do is pick a certain number of items. And if you pick 120 items and there's no fraud, then maybe you are, I'm absolutely just making these up. Maybe you're 92% sure that there is no fraud in the company. And as you pick more items, and there's still no fraud, oops, yeah, it will go up higher. So maybe you're up to whatever, 98%. So the more items that you pick with no fraud, the more comfort you have that there's no fraud exists. Classical sampling, we already did that. Classical sampling is first of all, it's substantive testing. Substantive from material must, in other words, these are dollar amounts. You guys recall this. This is mean per unit, oops. Oopsie daisy. Wait a minute, it's not meat per unit. mean per unit, ratio estimation, and difference estimation. So that's our classical sampling, and that's for substantive dollar amounts. What's our unit sampling? We just did that. That's that wacky one. And it's also substantive testing, and it is used only for possible overstatements. Now, it's really good for overstatements, but it can't be used for understatements. In fact, we ignore understatements using that method. Okay, so we already have those. So purpose testing is it's not really so much statistical as it is a trick to reduce your workload. And that is, let's say that you had attribute sampling, you had test of controls. Let's put that underneath there. You know, yes, no test. Did they sign the, purchase order and all that kind of stuff? Okay, so let's say that we have test of controls. Attribute sampling. And let's say that we picked, we need 100 items. And then we did some substantive testing. Let's say, ratio estimation. And let's say for ratio estimation testing, we need 235 items. Now, these are two different samples, two different sampling methods, I should say. But if these items are picked randomly, notice that you could use these same 100 items in this ratio estimation testing, so that 100 of these could be dual test samples. So for ratio estimation, you would only need to get another 135 items. So it's really there to make your picking of your sample more efficient. It has nothing to do with your results. If they're both random, they should give you a similar projections. But it's just so that you'd only have to take 135 additional. Any question on that thing? I don't think I explained it very well. So if you already pulled these items out, you may as well use them for both tests, I guess is the idea. And that would be a dual purpose. So you are going to use it for test controls, And you'll also use it for your ratio estimation testing. You know, any of these items you pick, these 100 items can be used for both of them. And you'd have to pick another 135 items just for the ratio estimation, but you would not have to pick the first five. Any questions on that? All right. All right, so this is something we kind of talked about before. Sampling risk. Sampling risk is, and this is the great thing about the normal distribution, is that you can actually quantify your risk. So for instance, if you audited to the 92nd percentage, then your risk is 8%. So you can quantify the risk. It's not 100% accurate. The only way you'd be 100% accurate is if you didn't take a sample, you looked at every single thing they had. But sampling risk is that you can quantify how much risk you want to take. The allowance for sampling risk is once you make that decision, how much, you know, how much leeway could there be in your sample? You know, like that if you have a projected value, for instance, this one has a projected value of 100,000. And standard deviation is 5,000. Oops, don't do that. All right, here we go. You know, so, okay, so what, you know, how sure do you want to be? And for instance, down here, taking this, what we just had here, your sampling risk at, is it two? 95%, so this is two standard deviations. So one, two. So that would be plus or minus 10,000. So this would be looking at a range between 90,000 to 110,000. Would be the range to be 95% sure. And given that same sample, given that same sample, we come down here, if you want to be 99.7% sure, it's going to have to increase it. So this will be plus or minus, what did I do here? Plus or minus 15,000, so this would be 85,000 to 115, given the same sample. So in other words, you're 95% sure that it's between 90,000 and 110. You're 99% sure. So the more sure you are, the larger that you're gonna have for this allowance for sampling risk, given the same sample. To be 99% sure, it's between 85 and 115,000, given the same sample. Again, you guys probably had this in your statistics class. So for the same sample size, a lower sampling risk, this is important. A lower sampling risk, so for instance, if it's 1% or whatever, 3%, I guess here, 0.3%. We have a higher allowance for sampling risk. The more sure you want to be is going to make that range wider. Now you say, well, how do I reduce that? The larger your sample, the more it's going to reduce your sampling risk. It kind of looks like this. Where am I at here? So, for instance, if you have a normal distribution that looks like this, the more items you take from a sample, you might narrow that up. You know, so the more items that you take will kind of make the bell curve look like this. You'll be more sure. You know, notice that this is a smaller span here than this. So the more you take, until if you go, if you take 100%, you'll know exactly what the, you know, what the total should be. But the more times you take, it'll narrow in that bell curve. Okay. Test the controls. Actually, let's take a break here. This is going to take a few minutes. Let's say be back at 2:50. Be back at 3. I've kind of expanded. Ooh, not 3,000. Be back at 3,000 o'clock. I kind of expanded this a little bit. So let's say, go ahead, let's take a break and be back at 3. Okay. Okay, test controls. These are tests for, this is the attributes. Oops, left off an R. So they're yes, no. Is, you know, whatever the control is, are they doing it or not? And it's literally not a yes, no test. So test controls, now it's exactly the same as what we did for, it's exactly the same as this, except that we use percentages. And here, let me show you. Okay. So instead of having, you know, between zero and some dollar amount, this will be 100%. This is when there's no errors. Okay, so when you do a test, and let's say that you come up with a 2% error rate on your sample, it's possible that it could be off more than that because this is a sample. So it's possible that it could be off by more than that. So this is, you have the same allowance here, but it's not going to be in dollars, it's going to be a percentage. So maybe like this is, say, 3%. So your upper limit would be the, those two together, you know, so this would be 5% total, because there's 3%. I could have wrote that a little bigger, I guess. Now you can't see it at all. That smudge is 3%. I'm an idiot. All right. So anyway, so it, but the same idea. It's the same. It's that curve, but it's not dollars. It's going to be percentage. Now, it is true it could go up this other way, at least up into 100% and stop there. Quite honestly, we don't care too much about that because that's not a, you know, if it's more reliable, we're not worried about that. We're more worried about this of relying on something that we shouldn't be. So we're more looking at it going that it could be worse than it is, even though it's possible it could be better. You know, we came up with 2% in our sample. Maybe our sample is off. Maybe it was only 1%. But we're not worried too much about that one. We're worried more about the going the other way. All right, so. Attribute sampling. And this is, attribute sampling is actually tested more than the, at least individually, any of the other substantive testing stuff. So take this out. All right. Just some controls, okay, blah, blah. Okay, so here's our control. So two managers, signatures on checks for written for more than $5,000. So if it's for more than $5,000, we want to have two managers sign off on it. $5,000 is a lot of money, and we want to make sure that if we're spending that kind of money, that at least two people know about it. It's kind of a check on whether the whatever it's for is on the up and up, let's say. Now, again, this is a yes and no test. So they either have two manager signatures, or they do not have, or they do not have two manager signatures. So is it yes or no? Either they have two manager signatures or they don't. All All right, suppose they choose 200 checks written for more than 5,000. The auditor allows for an error rate of 7%. The allowance for sampling risk, okay, that's that additional curve stuff underneath the it's 2%. Let me go to my ill-drawn thing here. One second. So this will be our allowance for sampling risk. There, let me make a new one. So whatever number we come up with, we're saying that this allowance for sampling risk is going to be 2%. So whatever number we come up with, it could be off by more than 2%, you know, for the problem we're doing. My sister's an artist. You'd never know about how I draw stuff. All right. Oh, not that. Here we go. Okay, so we have checks with two signatures. Okay, so of these checks, we took a sample of 200 checks. $194 had two signatures, and checks with only one signature was 6. So what is the error rate of the sample as a percentage? Out of the 200 items we had, 6 of them didn't have the required two signatures. They only had one signature.
So that means it's 3%, right?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. So this would be. Let me do the math here. So this would be errors of 6. Out of the 200. I'll clean this up in a second. Okay, so 0.03 or 3%, same thing. Okay, so now the question is, would you rely on these the assessed control risk? So as long as it's less than the 7%, when you do all the calculations, if it's less than 7%, you would. So the actual error rate is, sample error rate, I should say, is 3%. Oh, here, let me go back to the, you guys can't see what I'm doing. Oh, yeah, you can, hold on. Okay, so they're saying that this was, so 3% is our best estimate, right? So this is the error rate. But again, this is a sample, so it could be off by more. So the upper limit is going to be 3 plus 2 is going to be 5. I'll write this out in the handout in a second. So that's the upper limit. It's 5%. Okay. That's a pen covering up the answer. All right, so this is what we're talking about here. So the again, just like we did before, except in not in dollars, it's in percentages. So we think it's our best estimate is up by 3. It might be less than 3. It's a sample, but we're worried about how bad could it get. So we're going this way on it. Okay, it could be as bad as 5. Okay, so let's come back here. So it'll look like this. The the sample error rate is 3%. The allowance for sampling risk is, let me go one further here, 2%. Oops. So the upper limit on this is 5%. And they tell us that our tolerable, in other words, what we, the amount that we would be okay with, we allow for an error rate of 7%. So would we rely on the internal controls? So our sampling, so we'll be happy if we can get within 7%. Right now, our upper limit's 5. Can we rely on the internal controls? You can put it in chat if you want. This is sometimes called a tolerable rate, tolerable error rate. Anyone? In fact, let me put that in as tolerable error rate. I'm spelled tol. Too many L's. So from our testing, we came up that the upper limit is 5. Our tolerable error rate is 7. So can we rely on the controls? Oops. Anyone? Oh, flip a coin, be wrong once.
Is it yes?
Yeah, we can rely on them. It's less than we thought it was going to be. We thought, or do we allow for? We said, okay, it could be. We'll accept it if it's as much as 7. It's only 5, so yeah, we'll accept it. Okay, I gotta grab some space here somewhere. Okay, coming down here. So the auditor's assessment of control risk. Okay, so it's sort of like this. This is the, hold these. So this will be the auditor's. And this will be the actual. Now, the actual, we won't know unless we did 100% sample, but let me kind of fill these in for a little bit here. So for instance, if our assessment of the internal controls, if we say the controls are adequate and they actually are adequate, okay, then what we came up with was the correct conclusion. And notice if the auditors come up that the controls are inadequate and they actually are inadequate, that's correct too. The correct conclusion that those are, you know, from our sample, we came with those are correct, so that's fine. Now, the problem comes in on the mismatches, right? Where they don't match the actual, or your sample does not match up with what the actual is. Okay, so defectiveness of the controls and internal controls. So if we come up that they are inadequate, this is an incorrect rejection. That's an incorrect way to write incorrect. The other one over here is an incorrect acceptance. You know, we're accepting the controls as being adequate when really they're inadequate. Now, ideally you don't want either of those, but one of those is worse than the other, and we'll talk about that. The incorrect rejection means that you're going to have an inefficient audit. Okay, so this one will be an inefficient audit. This one will be an ineffective audit. So coming out over here to this incorrect rejection, inefficient audit. So let's say we take our sample, and given the example we have up here, maybe we come out that there, you know, whatever, we have a higher error rate than is really in the population as a whole, and it tells us that we can't rely on the internal controls. So we do more testing, more substantive testing. So in this case, we'll do too much substantive testing. You know, for dollar amounts. So it's inefficient. We did more substantive testing than we needed to. I'm still going to need more room. Okay, so incorrect acceptance, ineffective audit is this. We have too little substantive testing. So we think that we're auditing to the 95% level, and really we're auditing to the 60% level, or whatever it is. Which one of these is more dangerous, incorrect acceptance or incorrect rejection for the auditors?
Would it be acceptance?
Yeah. Yeah. You think everything's okay. You sign off on the audit report, you think everything's fine when it's not. So this ineffective audit, this is the one you're really worried about. This one is, you know, while it could be annoying, it's, you know, you'll come up with the correct solution. It'll just be that you did it inefficiently. You did more than you needed to get it. But at least you'll come up with the correct, you know, eventually, you know, because you'll do the additional substantive testing more than you need to, you'll come up with the correct overall opinion of the audit. So this one, you think everything's fine and it's not. So this is one that people really worry about, is this incorrect acceptance, that it is an ineffective audit. And this is one that they're going to worry about more. Now, one more thing you got to remember . You know, if you're auditing to say the 95% level, you know, think about what that means. If you're auditing that it's not me, I have different hair. If you know that, I forgot what I was saying. Oh. I remember now. If you're already at a 95% level, that means 5% of the time, it's going to be wrong. And that's just sampling. You know, you take a random sample and you do it at the 95% level, 5% of the time, you're going to be wrong. 1 out of 20 times, you're going to be wrong. And that's, there's nothing you can really do about that. You can make larger samples to try to reduce that. But, you know, 95% level, 5% of the time, you're going to be wrong. So this does happen. It's, and you know, the if you're doing audit, you know, if you do 20 audits, one of them's going to have, you're sampling for accounts receivable, one of them's going to be wrong, you know, statistically, one of them's going to be wrong. So okay, any questions on that? So coming out here, we're going to do a few. We're going to do a few of these just to kind of get used to our new thing here about the sampling. So I don't think I've talked about what we do test the controls. We do test the controls so that we can rely on the controls. Okay, so, you know, one reason why we check for the signatures is that, are there controls here? Are they using the controls? Can we rely on the controls? And we're doing that so that we can reduce the substantive testing. You know, so we might plan that we're going to test the controls, and if everything's okay with the controls, then we're going to test for 500 items, say. I'm just making that up. But, you know, so if we are, you know, if we can rely on the controls, we're going to take a sample of 500 items. Now, if we can't rely on the controls, what does that mean? We have to sample more than 500 items for the dollar amounts for substantive testing. So, you know, you're trying to reduce the amount of substantive testing you do. That's why we're doing the test of controls. So, keeping that in mind, you know, when they go together. So the internal controls that we're testing, if we can rely on them, it reduces the substantive test. Now you might say, well, can we just skip doing the test of controls completely? Yes, you can. You know, if you're just doing the financial audit, you can say, okay, I'm not going to rely on the controls. I'm just going to take a bigger sample of the dollar amounts. That's fine. We do it for especially larger companies. You're almost required. You're pretty much required to do it. You know, you can't do that with, say, Walmart or anything like that. You have to rely on the controls to some extent. So, but anyway, the controls are there. We do the testing of the controls so that we can reduce the amount of substantive testing and reduce the cost of the audit. That's really what we're looking at. Okay. So let's look at number 6. We have an allowable tolerable rate, or tolerable rate, another way of saying it. 8%. We do our testing. We have an allowance for sampling risk of 4%. Our actual rate is 3. Can we rely on the test controls? Do something here. So this would be an upper limit of 7. That looks funny. Yeah, I'll do it like this. There we go. So we do our testing. The testing's in green. We do. We have an allowance for sampling risk. So that's the kind of bell curve thing. 4%. The actual amount is 3. So the upper limit's 7. We'll allow for up to 8%. So can we rely on the controls?
Yeah, we can.
Yep. Yes, it's less. Okay, second one, same thing. Allowable. Oh man, how many do I have here? Oh, I get it. I know what I did. Okay, never mind. I know where I'm going with it. I remember now. Okay, so the allowable is 5%. Allowance for sampling risk. We take the sample, we actually don't find anything wrong. So can we rely on these? And again, yeah, it's less than the tolerable rate or the allowable rate. So we will. I wish that this is one of those weird things, the allowance and allowable sound so much alike, but allowable and tolerable are the same thing. So yes, we can rely on it. It is less than the rate. Okay, go down here. The upper limit is 8%. The allow amount is 4. No, it's not. The other one is 7. So can we rely on this? No. That's right. No, we can't rely on it. The upper limit is 8% on our sample, even though our best estimate is off by 4. Oops, second one here. It's off by 4. The upper limit is 8, and we cannot rely on this. Oh, you see what I did down here? This is me being evil. Do you see that? I put the allowable tolerable rate second there. So this will be the upper limit. Oh, what did I do here? Somehow I Okay, let's try this again. I'm still evil. So that part was correct. So this would be the upper limit. So I guess my point in this one is just if they can come in any order, you know. There's no standard form for showing you how this. So the allowance for sampling risk and the actual error rate, those go to the upper limit. And we'll compare that to the allowable or tolerable rate. Can we rely on them?
Yes.
Yeah. Upper limit is 5 and the tolerable is 6. Okay, down here, it gets a little bit more into the into relating it to substantive testing. Okay, the allowed sampling risk is 2%, the actual error rate, so the upper limit would be 6%. And the allowable rate is 8%. Substantive testing, ratio estimation, planned substantive testing size is 220 items. So we did this test. Now, will that increase the number of items we need to take? Now, remember, we this is all part of the plan. We did this. So the plan, substantive test, we have ratio estimation, which is one of the classical sampling items. Are we going to need to take more items or not? Well, because we can rely on the controls, no, we don't need to take any more items. We can rely on the controls, we don't need to take any more items. And the fact that this is lower than this, depending on how low it goes, you may even be able to take fewer amounts of these 220, maybe you take 200 or whatever, but you certainly don't need to take any additional items. So this is definitely that we don't need to take any additional items. We're comfortable with the controls. We have our sample size of 220. We don't need to take any more. Okay, oh, look at that, I switched it up again. You see that, do you guys catch that? Put the allowable first now, allowable, tolerable. Okay. So the upper limit is 6%. We're going to have monetary unit sampling. Okay, that's sample size 150 items. Will the auditor need to increase the substantive testing? Okay, so can we rely on the controls? Okay. We cannot rely on the controls. We're the tolerable rate is allowable rate is 5%. Our upper limit is 6. So we're too high. So will the auditor need to increase the testing? Yes. You know, now we can't rely on the controls. So we cannot just take 150 items, so we're going to increase it. I'm just going to make this up. Maybe you have to increase it to, I don't know, 200 items. You know, because you can't rely on the controls, so now you have to do more substantive testing. You do the test controls to reduce the amount of testing that you do. If you can rely on them, you can stick to your plan. If you cannot rely on them, then you will have to take more items for the substantive testing. So you do test controls because you want to rely on the controls. And if you can't do that, then you say, okay, go on to plan B. We'll do the take more items from the for the substantive testing. Okay, number 12. Tolerable rate. Upper limit is 4%. Okay, we're doing mean per unit sampling. That probably doesn't matter too much, but as far as the sample size is concerned, anyways, 78 items. Do we have to take more items, or is that okay? Do we have to increase the items? What do you think? These are the most missed ones on the test, by the way, out of all the sampling stuff. You know, the more points are missed on this than on the monetary unit sampling. Usually, I hope no one misses any of them, but passed. So can we rely on the internal controls?
I say yeah.
Yep. Yeah, you can rely on the internal controls. So do you need to increase? No. And this one is a little bit, because this is so much less, they may even be able to you know, again, this would be a possibility. You know, if these come out way better than you expect, it's possible you can reduce the substantive testing. Say, okay, well, I guess they've improved since last time, and we don't need to take this big of a sample. because it's their controls are better. Okay. Yeah, look how big I made that. Look how big 13 is. What did I do? Oh, substantive procedure. Okay. I still wonder why I had that so large. Okay, substantive test. This is, these are for dollar amounts. 14 or something. Okay. So these for dollar amounts. Yeah, the dollars, you know, classical sampling, which we did. And these are dollar amounts. How much is it off by? What do we project it to be? You know, is it same thing here? Monetary unit. What's the projected misstatement and all that? The same thing is here. It goes for the other one that we had. If we say they are not materially misstated and they are not, we have the correct conclusion. Ah, now I'll leave it. And if we say they are materially misstated and they actually are materially misstated, then this is correct also. Now, if they are materially misstated and we think they are not, this is incorrect acceptance. And if we say they're materially misstated when they're actually not, this is incorrect rejection. And again, this one is the same idea applies to these, applies to the other one. This one leads to an ineffective audit. And this one will lead to an inefficient audit. Because eventually we'll take more items and can I do something there? We come up with a materially misstated, we'll take a bigger sample, whatever. And if you do it, if you run it over enough times, you're gonna get the correct one. So this is gonna be an incorrect rejection. This is gonna be an inefficient audit. You're gonna do more work than you need to. This one, incorrect acceptance. This is the more dangerous one. This is probably the most dangerous one there is in auditing, even more than the internal control one, because this is where you think everything's fine, you put your stamp of approval on it, and they're materially misstated, and you have no idea. Okay, last thing. Hey, this is obviously going to be the last thing we do. We're not going to get to the chapter 7 handout, but I'm glad we got this one done. This one's more important. I don't know, it's not more important, but. Okay, initial test of controls indicate that the controls cannot be relied upon. I don't know why I put suppose in there, but anyway. So what should the auditor do? So you're testing the internal controls and you realize that you cannot rely on these internal controls. So what are you going to do? A, increase the test of controls, or B, increase the substantive procedures, in other words, dollar amounts. So you're testing the controls, you get halfway into it, and you go, we cannot rely on these. What are you going to do next? And remember, the audit report is going to be on whether or not the financial statements are materially misstated. So So what are you going to do? You can't rely on the controls. Are you going to test the controls more? Or are you going to increase the substantive testing?
Is it B?
Yeah. Yep. You're going to increase, because you can't rely on the controls. There's no reason to test them anymore. I mean, you're only testing them so that you can rely on them. So if you can't rely on them, well, forget it. You'll go to this increase of substantive procedure. So here is the overall, the last point of this is that there is an inverse relationship between of controls and substantive testing. So it's an inverse relationship. The more of one you do, the less of the other. So if you can rely on the controls, you do more of the controls and do less of the substantive testing. If you can't rely on the controls, you do less of the testing controls, maybe even zero, and do the substantive testing and do more substantive testing. So it's an inverse relationship between them. Okay, well, I apologize for not getting to chapter 7, but I'm glad we got through this one. I don't know why I didn't think it took this long. All right, any questions? Okay, I think I've had enough. Have you guys had enough? All right, I think let me check and see if that is, do I have that in Blackboard? Yeah. The sampling overview is in there. Okay. Any questions? The test is due this Friday, I think. Isn't it? Is it the 5th? Yes. Okay, so if you haven't got the test, I know some of you have already got the test in, but if you don't have the test in, try to get it in by Friday. Any questions? All right, I'll go out and enjoy the winter weather we're having. See you guys. And I will give you guys extra credit for being here.
Thanks, Professor. Have a good one. Good night.